Hi, I'm Ashley Sides, and for today's Sandwiching and History Tour, we've got a very special building that takes us all the way back to the earliest days of Little Rock. Now, you know, cities are always changing, so in the midst of modernization and progress, how do you hold on to your roots? That's where historic preservation comes in, and we've got a perfect example of that right here at the corner of 3rd and Cumberland Streets. The Hinderliter House is probably the oldest building in Little Rock. And thanks to one of the state's earliest historic preservation efforts, this building still stands to take us back to a time when Arkansas was just a territory, Little Rock was just a modest settlement, and this was a grog shop.
You can think of the house's history in two parts. Act One, the first century, when people lived and worked there. Jesse Hinderliter moved to Little Rock from St. Louis in the mid-1820s. Having just become the capital of Arkansas Territory in 1821, the young community was attracting new settlers, but its population was still small. Hinderliter purchased land from Chester Ashley and built his house sometime around 1827. At the time, it was on the edge of town. You wouldn't know by looking, but it's a hewn log house, as most buildings in Little Rock were in those early years. Log houses were less expensive to build than frame or brick houses. And besides, the skilled labor needed for those kinds of structures was in limited supply. When Hinderliter built his house, Little Rock only had about 60 buildings, and 3/4 of them were built of logs like this one. And this is the only one that survives. We know very little of the other early log buildings, because little mention was made of them at the time. They were practical, but not prestigious like frame or brick, and history forgot them. That's why the Hinderliter House is such a unique and important relic from Little Rock's early days. It was probably built in stages. The shorter east side may have been the original part, with the west side added soon after, by 1833. The absence of logs in the central part of the structure indicates that the two sections may originally have been separate, perhaps as a dog trot, and later joined. The weatherboard, or clapboard siding, was added early on, maybe the late 1830s, as was often done to log buildings, to make them more weathertight, and so they would look more refined. The porch on the back would also have been added in the late 1830s or 40s. As the decade of the 1830s opened, the enterprising Mr. Hinderliter probably felt pretty good about his prospects. He was establishing himself in the growing territorial capital. With this new house, he had a new home, as well as a new business. He would use the upstairs as his personal quarters and boarding rooms, while running a grog shop on the ground floor. A later source also claims he operated a grocery store in the building. In addition, he owned 2 enslaved individuals who lived there and worked on the grounds. Hinderliter married Sophia Chandler in 1828, and they probably dreamed of long-term plans. But his newly built house would go on to fare better than his family. Mrs. Hinderliter died in 1831, and they had no children. Meanwhile, running a grog shop brought its own challenges. Grog refers to alcoholic beverages, and a grog shop is just another term for tavern or bar. In 1833, after having too much to drink, 2 men broke into Hinderliter's house and attacked him. As they struggled, Hinderliter stabbed and killed one of the intruders. The other one escaped. Hinderliter turned himself in to the authorities, but was acquitted because he had acted out of self-defense. Hinderliter himself, though, died in 1834. At his death, he still owed $128 on the lots he had purchased from Chester Ashley. Ashley reacquired the property, and the house was rented out for a while. It changed owners several times over the succeeding decades, and was put to a variety of uses. It continued to be used as a tavern or boarding house for the most part, but for a brief period in the late 1860s or 70s, the School for the Deaf met there. By the mid-1880s, the building had become tenements with a restaurant, and part of it had a laundry business. But that area had become a seedy neighborhood known for murders and a red light district, with the old Hinderliter place hosting ladies of the night. Despite the neighborhood's bad reputation at the turn of the 20th century, the Hinderliter house did enjoy celebrity in one respect. Popular legend held that back in 1835, the old grog shop had been the meeting place of the last territorial legislature before Arkansas statehood. Historians are skeptical of this claim, since all the documentary evidence from 1835 indicates that the territorial legislature was meeting in church buildings. But legends are powerful things, and by the 1930s, as the curtain was falling on Act 1 of the history of this dilapidated 100-year-old building, it would be this legend that would raise the curtain for an Act 2. Act 2, the 2nd century, preserving and interpreting the Hinderliter House. The Hinderliter House that we see today does not look like the building shown in the old photographs from the 1930s. It looks like the original grog shop from the 1830s. Or at least it's supposed to. I asked Victoria Chandler from the Historic Arkansas Museum to shed some light on the Hinderliter House's remarkable transformation and how it became a core part of the institution now called the Historic Arkansas Museum.
How it looks today is kind of a good representation of what it would have looked like in the 1830s. But I think it's really important that this building was continually inhabited up until the 1930s.
In other words, it had evolved a lot over 100 years as people put it to different uses. But by the 1930s, it looked like the end of the road for the Hinderliter House and the other buildings on this rundown block of town.
Everyone wanted this spot to be demoed and have new buildings brought up on it.
But one woman with a vision spearheaded a preservation effort to save these old buildings and try to restore them to how they looked in the territorial period so that the public could visit them as a museum. And she started with the Hinderliter.
Louise Loughborough is kind of, you know, our founder of the Arkansas Territorial Restoration, now Historic Arkansas Museum. But she really is the pioneer of preservation for the state. She worked with the group that preserved the old State House building. You know, she comes from a long line of Arkansas families. You know, her grandfathers and great-grandfathers would have known Jesse Hinderliter and lived during this time, so she's not very far removed. She was a big champion for historic preservation, and it's very appropriate because Hinderliter is the whole reason we have the museum that we have today. She thought of it as being the city of the three capitals, the current capital we have, the old State House, and this building, which at the time it was erroneously believed that it was the last meeting for the Arkansas Territorial Convention and the signing of the Constitution, which that didn't happen here. But that was, you know, kind of widely reported at the time. And so she championed it as a city of three capitals and thought she'd make the block like Colonial Williamsburg. And so this effort to restore blocks 31, 32, and 33 was the first full-scale effort in the state to preserve not a singular site, but multiple structures. But she single-handedly raised funds and lobbied the state legislature to save this block. And specifically, she started with the structure. She partnered with Max Mayer, who's an architect, and together they kind of had this plan for restoring what would be then the Arkansas Territorial Restoration. They thought they were restoring to 1830s, like 1835, the last meeting of the territorial legislation. I think that's the date they were going for in their head.
But there are no photographs from those early days, no drawings. There was very little in the way of description. So Loughborough and Mayer had to base their restoration on similar period buildings, on evidence preserved in the structure itself, and on their own inferences and interpretations.
At the time, it was a restaurant inside and a bar. There was also a lean-to structure that had a lawyer's office. It was tenants upstairs, but there are many, many windows and the doors are different. And so we're not quite sure which. There are some of the windows with their glass, they do date to the 1800s. We're not quite sure when, but they are historic. But then Max Mayer took out some. He might have, you know, the windows that we do have, he might have relocated. We just don't know. His drawings frequently, he changed the layout of the windows a lot. And you can see that, you know, image of before preservation's done, and you can just kind of tell the difference.
There are features of the building that are known to be from the early period. Dendrochronology readings have dated some of the logs to 1832 or before.
So we know at least like the log structure was here at that point. We're in the grog shop room, and what you can see, the walled boards are from the 1830s, 20s. Some of the beams on the ceiling date for that period. Another kind of thing that dates to the 1800s, the mantle in the dining room, that Empire style mantle, is from the 1830s.
So the Hinderliter House can take us back to Arkansas's territorial days. And that's what Mrs. Loughborough was trying to restore when she thought that it had been the territorial capital in 1835. But every era has left its imprint on the house, not least of all Loughborough's own preservation work with the territorial restoration. That's now a very significant part of this house's history.
we're now on the National Register as a historic district, but we're not for the reasons people think. People would think, oh, these historic block. We're actually on the register because of the preservation efforts of Louise Loughborough. And so we're on the registered classified for the 1930s, which is very appropriate for this building because so much of this is a question of what is from the 1830s or from the 1930s or any time in between there, because it's been inhabited that entire period. You know, the goal of this originally, this whole institution was to save this Capitol building. And it's interesting how that's really shifted. You know, 81 years now, we've been a museum. It's a really long time. It's generations of different ideas and missions and kind of purposes. You know, we're working with a historic architect right now, and we had this initial conversation. He's like, y'all have to make a decision of how you're going to preserve this building. Is it the building from the 1830s or is it the 1930s restoration project? And we are leaning now towards the 1930s because the elements that are the 1830s we have identified and we can work to preserve those, and that falls in line with the mission of the 1930s preservation efforts. But you know, Jesse Hinderliter died, and then this building just remain vacant. It was quickly inhabited. Improvements were constantly made. You know, some things might date to the 1840s. That's also worth preserving. And so I think, you know, historic site museums get in this tricky business. And preservation also, if you like stick to this one date, you have to sacrifice the other years. And it's all important. I think that's a big thing, is that we've remained a historic block of downtown, and we want to kind of tell the story of downtown Little Rock. And kind of having this flexible time frame from the 1830s to the 1930s, this 100 years, gives us a lot to interpret. But we are focusing on the 1930s preservation of the, treating this building through that lens, which of course factors into the early 1830s, but it's really focused on that period.
So the Hinderliter House and the other buildings at the Historic Arkansas Museum still have a lot more to teach us about Little Rock history, but we're going to have to be patient for some of it. Especially in the case of the Hinderliter. It's closed to the public right now while it undergoes some much needed preservation work.
We have a big drainage issue on the grounds over here, and we've had it for years. We're working to put in a French drain system to kind of help filter off some of the water, but that's caused the issues of the floorboards in here. We're not quite sure. We don't think the whole foundation is rotting, but there are definitely sections where it needs to be addressed. But the porch right now, because the water drainage issue, the joists are rotting a little bit. It's just not safer to have so many visitors, you know, especially with school groups. You get a lot of those coming in. It's just too much. So we've closed off Hinderliter for now, taken out most of the objects, and hopefully by the end of this month we're gonna have a progress report of where we're going from here. So we are lucky that we have the Arkansas Natural and Cultural Resources grant, and so that helps to fund the rehabilitation of structures like this. And so we'll be working on that over the next couple years. What we're making an effort to do in Hinderliter, we already have this partly, but we are trying to fill the houses with reproductions. This is also so we can have more engaging, you know, activities. We want people to be able to sit down. Eventually they can jump on the beds, do whatever. Really experience all the sensory parts of living in one of these buildings at the time.
Well, that'll be something to look forward to. The Hinderliter's future promises to be as exciting as its past. Rather than being frozen in a moment in time, this building tells stories from many eras as its history continues to be written.
Thanks for joining us in our virtual sandwiching and history tour of the Hinderliter House. I hope you'll come back next month when our tour takes us to the Engelberger House, one of only two Queen Anne-style houses in North Little Rock. Not only is it beautiful, it's also got a fascinating history, and you'll only get to see it in our virtual tour. I hope to see you then.